Let us pray.
Gracious and loving Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to gather in your name. We thank you for the chance to worship you. Most of all, we thank you for who you are and your faithfulness to us for all of time. And also, Lord, that you give us a job to do. We're not left here to sit on our laurels, but indeed, when you came into the world and left, Lord, you commissioned the church, this church, to be about your business. So, Lord, help us now to learn what that business might mean for us as a church and for us as individuals. And I pray, dear Lord, you know that I'm a sinner, that you'd push these, that you would push me aside and make these words pleasing in your sight alone, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. In Jesus' most precious and holy name, we pray. Amen. Amen. How many of us are familiar with those words that we just read? From Matthew's gospel. I think many of us are familiar with those words, and they're important words, aren't they? They're important in part because of the context here. Jesus is, as Mark tells the story, Jesus is giving the disciples a final command. These are Jesus' final words, his farewell words to the disciples, to you and me, who are also called his disciples. And our farewell words mean a lot, don't they? Some of the most blessed times I've had as a pastor around deathbeds and the things that people often say. Our last words are incredibly important. And here are Jesus' last words to his disciples as Matthew recounts those words. And so central to your life and my life. Perhaps that's why we do call them the Great Commission. How many have heard that? Pastors often point out that it's not the Great Suggestion. This is the Great Commission. We are to go, therefore, and make disciples of the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey all that Jesus has commanded you and me. But I wonder how seriously we really take those words. How much to our hearts do we apply that commission? Have you really sat down and thought about that commission? How many of us have thought about what Jesus means? In fact, I suspect often when we think of what Jesus means with these words, we think that it is a call to go forth and evangelize, don't we? In fact, the entire modern missionary movement is based on this verse, that we're to go out and tell other people about Jesus. And hear me, that's so important. Jesus commissions us to tell others about Jesus, and I trust that you are telling others about Jesus, but that's only half of our commission, at least as I read Matthew. There's another part of our commission that we often miss. We get so focused on evangelism that we forget another element. How many of us have seen those visual puzzles where you look at something and you see it, and then somebody comes along and says, "Don't you see this other aspect?" and it like opens a world for you? Well, that's the way I think the commission is. We so focus on evangelism with the Great Commission that we forget a whole other aspect of what this commission is all about, this command for your life and my life. Which raises the question, what is the other aspect, Pastor? Can we do that in unison? What is the other aspect, Pastor? Well, I'm glad you asked. I thought you might not this morning, but I'm glad you asked. Here's the other aspect. Yes, we are called to go and tell the nations, but we are called to go and make disciples of all the nations, teaching them to obey all that Jesus has taught you and me. The other aspect of that commission, just as essential as evangelism, is to teach, to make disciples. It's central to the Great Commission. It's not just a suggestion. Jesus has now gained authority. He's been risen from the dead, and now he's passing his authority on to you and to me to, yes, go and tell others of him, but also to go forth and to teach. See, either we make disciples, either we teach, or we break our Lord's Great Commission. You see, there's a challenge there for many of us, I think, At least as I've lived out my life in the Christian community, and the challenge goes something like this. So often when it comes to faith, we just assume that faith is something we'll learn along the way. Kind of like osmosis. That faith is just something that kind of happens to us. If you attend church long enough, you're going to have faith. It's something that most of us would say it's not something you're taught. It's something that's subjective, it's inward, it's about the heart. But it should be something that we should teach like other subjects. This comes out oftentimes when parents come to me, and some very well-meaning, and they'll say something like this: I'm not going to teach my child about Jesus. I want them to reach an age and then they can make that decision for themselves. Have you ever heard that? Some of us have thought it, perhaps, right? In other words, faith is something that's subjective. It's not something that can be taught from the outside. It's just something you kind of come about to by going to church. And it comes out often with us adults as well. It goes something like this: well, Pastor, I've gone to confirmation, or I've been converted. I've learned what I need to know. And that's when we stop learning. That's when we stop learning. But according to Jesus, nothing could be further from the truth. According to Jesus' great commission, not a suggestion, His great commission, you and I are to teach. We are to learn. We are to be students. In fact, one commentator paraphrases the verse something like this: go to all the ethnic groups of the world and teach them to be my students. You and I are called to be students of Jesus Christ. When we send our children off to school, you and I should be going off to school as well. Today, when we celebrate Rally Day and the teaching ministries of the church, it's just not about our young people. Weren't they cute? Didn't they do a great job? It's not just about that. You don't stop learning when you follow Jesus Christ. We are to be lifelong learners. We are to teach. And we are to be taught. It's part of the Great Commission. Just imagine if we treated other areas of our life like we often treat faith. How many teachers do we have? Raise your hand. Some of you teach math or science. Imagine if you went to your students and said, well, you'll just pick up that along the way. How about us as parents, if we said to our students or our children, you don't have to go and learn math, you just pick it up along the way. When you get at a point that you want to learn it for yourself, then you can learn math. Or how about English, if we said, well, you just pick up English along the way, and then you'll make it yourself. None of us would say that, would we? We know that math and science and English is essential to who they are. We know that it's something that needs to be taught, and so we teach it. And yet when it comes to faith, that's so often what we do, don't we? We just throw up our hands and assume that somewhere along the line our children are just going to pick it up. But when they reach a certain age, they'll make the faith their own. Or how about for us older adults? Imagine if we approached our careers where we said, well, I got my degree hanging on the wall. I'm done learning. You know anybody like that? What if in our professional lives, if we quit learning at the moment we had our degree on the wall? What would happen to so many of the professionals? As a doctor, or as a teacher, as a pastor, as a parent, all areas of aspect, either you're learning or you're dead. You have to be continually learning, don't you? It's a part of life. In fact, many of us we're encouraged to do continuing ed. How many of us are encouraged by our profession to do continuing ed? For good reason. Because learning is essential. See, our Roman Catholic brothers and sisters perhaps know that better than we Protestants. They used to have a saying that went something like this. You know, they would form schools, and they'd say something like this: if you give us your children for the first few years of their education, we'll make them a Catholic for life. Because they know how important learning is, how important education is, how important teaching the faith is. That's the foundation. And many of us can think of the importance of somebody in our life who taught us about the faith. I was just preparing for this sermon today, and in the back of my mind, I remember a lady who was, I attended the Episcopal Church. as a young kid, and it's one of those kind of murky memories I have, but I remember sitting around the little table, and I remember how kind she was, and how she taught me about Jesus. In fact, if I remember correctly, she asked me to commit my life to Christ, and I remember she talked really funny. Even more funny than Minnesotans talk. So I called my mom. I said, "Mom, I have a distinct memory of a lady when we attended the Episcopal Church that taught me." She said, "Oh," she said, "that was Marguerite Wide. She was from England. And she didn't have any children of her own. But she taught all the youngsters of that church for year after year after year after year." And when I'm honest, part of the reason I'm here, and part of the reason I'm a follower of Jesus Christ, is because Marjorie laid that foundation. She so impressed me with love and grace, and so taught me about Jesus that I know that she was a big part of why I'm a follower of Jesus Christ today. Can you think of some people in your life? Any of you think of some people in your life? And she was just one. Ellen, who can you think of?
Miss Minnie.
Miss what?
Miss Minnie.
Miss Minnie?
Minnie Roush.
Minnie Roush?
Was our teacher before school.
Before school.
Cool.
Any others? Can you think of teachers that touched you, especially in your faith, in your faith development?
Mrs. Cunningham. Okay.
First and second grade Sunday school. Any others you can think of that touched you? Yes.
Mrs. Heffelbauer, but I was a teenager.
You were a teenager. So it occurs throughout all of life, right? How many of us, I mean, in all honesty, that you can trace one or two or many people? Just raise your hand that somebody touched your life and taught you about Jesus Christ. Look at that. You see, faith is something we need to teach, and it's so essential. And that's a challenge for us, to teach the faith. And we have to keep challenging one another to teach the faith. But it doesn't end there, according to the Great Commission. The challenge goes on. Sometimes we miss another aspect of our passage. We overlook it. Yes, we're to teach, but we're not to just teach any old thing. What are we to do? We are to teach others to obey all that Jesus has commanded us. Other translations capture, I think, the meaning a little better. We are to teach others what Jesus has taught us. See, we're not only to teach, we're to be learners. We are made disciples in order to make disciples. The implication is obvious for you and for me. We are disciples in order to make others disciples. We are to be learners ourselves so that we can teach others. How often, when we're honest, do we stop learning somewhere along the line? Especially we adults, don't we? How often do we forget that special aspect of what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ? And indeed, that's what it means to be a disciple. Remember, in the ancient times, that was the primary teaching method. If you became a disciple of somebody, you would spend 24/7 with them. You would spend all aspects of your life with them. Just as Jesus said to the disciples, "Come and follow me." When they followed him, they spent 24/7 with him. They ate together. They slept, remember, single rooms, in the same room together. They did everything together, because teaching just wasn't a matter of learning head knowledge. It was a matter of watching the way the person lived. Education wasn't a matter of simply the head, it was also a way of life. That's what it meant to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. Evidently, for you and me to be the best teachers, we have to be those who are learning from Jesus even as we speak today. And those are our best teachers. Can you imagine somebody saying, "I'm going to teach you math, but I don't know how to do math. I'm going to teach you English, and I don't know how to write myself." It doesn't work, does it? The best teachers are those who are being taught themselves. Are you learning from Jesus Christ? Are you a lifelong learner from Jesus Christ? Or have you stopped learning somewhere along the line? If you have, you're not fulfilling the Great Commission. If we as a church are no longer doing that, we're falling short of the Great Commission. Jesus seems to envision that you and I will be disciples. That is, we are those individuals who are with him, that we are so in love with him that we commit our everything to him, and we follow and listen and observe him. We just totally become, you know, enmeshed in who he is, and out of that we invite others to be a part of that inner group. That's what a disciple was. That's the call for you and for me. See, being a disciple just isn't showing up for church. That won't cut it. Being a disciple just isn't learning right doctrine. It's just not a matter of the head. It's just not a matter of saying certain words. It's just not a matter of a profession. Being a disciple is lifelong. It's not just about one aspect of our lives. It's about our whole lives. It's about being a lifelong learner. That's the other side of the Great Commission. Yes, we are called to go and make disciples, you and me, but we are also called to be disciples ourselves. We are called to teach, and we are called to learn. How are you and I doing, honestly? Have you maybe placed your degree on the wall and said, I finished confirmation and I'm done learning? Have you maybe had a conversion experience and you say, I've got it, right? In fact, I understand in the original Greek the word for disciple is a verb here. It means it's not a finished process. It's ongoing. It's continuous. It never ends. In fact, I would suggest that you and I will be disciples for all of eternity. Won't it be great to study at Jesus' feet for all of eternity? I'm looking forward to it. But there's no place in the process that you and I can stop. Learning and teaching is essential to the mission of the church and Jesus' Great Commission for this church and every church. In fact, he says in that, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That means he's forming a group around himself. What was the favorite title used of Jesus? Rabbi, which means teacher. Are you still learning from Jesus? How are you and I doing? Are we part of that intimate group? Are we so in love with Jesus that we hang on every word? Do we realize that faith isn't just about a way of the head, but it's a way of life, it's a way of being? Are you and I still learning? And are we as a church still teaching in identifying that as an important, indeed essential part of what it means to follow the Great Commission? Today's Rally Sunday, and obviously it fits in. We are talking about the teaching ministries and the learning ministries of the church. I want to encourage you, if you have young people, to make sure that they're part of that learning process. Because we have some Marjorie Wides in our church. They are shaping young lives for Jesus Christ. The Bible says if you teach them in the way of the Lord, though they may go astray, they will return. How essential is your task and my task as aunts and uncles and grandparents and parents to make sure that our children learn the faith? I encourage you to do that, and then to not only just do it for your children and young people, but do it yourself. Learn. Be a student. Continue to push yourself. Be a disciple of Jesus Christ. We have many classes that we offer. Mark one on your calendar and be a part of it. And if not in our church, find another small Christian group and be a part of it. Learn. Be a true disciple. Follow Jesus Christ as he commissions us to follow. Let each of us do so. Aristotle once said these profound words. He said, in many ways, we owe more to our teachers than we do our parents. Our parents give us life, but our teachers give us the good life. If we apply that to Jesus, not only do our parents give us life, but Jesus gives us the abundant life and eternal life. We owe him our everything. Our hearts, our bodies, our souls, and our minds. home as a place where the students of Jesus gather and where class is held each and every Sunday. Let us pray. Gracious and loving Lord, we thank you that you push us. We thank you that you call us to be lifelong learners. We thank you that you call us to be disciples. We thank you for the opportunity of our church to form young wives for your kingdom. And then we pray for our church and each of us as individuals that this might be a place where we do learn from one another and we do fulfill your great commission to, yes, go and bring the good news to others, but also this might be a place where we make disciples, students of you. All this we pray and ask in Jesus' most precious and holy name. Amen.